Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming here today, and big shout out to the organizers for putting this event together. I'm very honored to get to be on this stage and talk to you about some really serious stuff. In 2016, the most pressing topic of the year for software engineers was empathy. And in 2017, the topic of the year was inclusion. And this year, the topic seems to be about ethics, which I'm really excited about because the discourse grows more and more concerning each day. And even though these issues feel like new wounds, they have a long history steeped in bias and systemic oppression, and we need to pay attention to these things. Data and Society Research Institute recently hosted author of Algorithms of Oppression, Professor Sofia Umoja Nobel, to talk about data discrimination and technological redlining. And at the event, Nobel reflected on her upbringing in Fresno, California. She recalled seeing the KKK in their garb in public, neighboring sundown towns that enforced a sunset curfew on black people. The black poor side of town was a food desert, which meant that there were no grocery stores at all. And with the buses not servicing the town after 7 p.m., that meant that there was a huge burden placed on the poor and the black people of Fresno, California. And her talking about that history and having grown up in that environment and how it shaped her to be the person who she was and pushed her to do the research that she did to publish the book Algorithms of Oppression reminded me about the forgotten New York City neighborhood of Manhattan Town. So in 1905, Phillip Peyton Jr., also known as the father of Harlem, broke the color line below Columbia University when he began purchasing real estate on the Upper West Side on 99th Street and then 98th Street between Columbus Avenue and Central Park West. There were a lot of notable residents of Manhattan Town, including some of the most venerated artists and intellectuals of the Harlem Renaissance. And one of my favorite little tidbits was of like trivia facts was that Sadie Fagan, the mother of famous jazz singer Billie Holiday, ran a cafe in Manhattan Town called Mom Holidays, where she famously got in an argument with Billie over wanting to borrow money, and that is when Billie came up with the title of the song God Bless the Child. But by 1955, those two blocks on 99 and 98 were nothing but rubble. In 1949, President Harry Truman signed the Housing Act, and Title I of the Housing Act gave Robert Moses, in his position as chairman of the New York City Slum Clearance Committee, the power to condemn buildings and steal land under the guise of urban renewal. Moses would then grant the land to companies of his choosing, often as a way to amass political favor. Manhattan Town was literally the very first neighborhood that Moses picked to do this to. Residents of Manhattan Town were evicted in 1951. The buildings were torn down, and most of it was just rubble until the 1960s when the Park West Village apartments were built. Moses did irrevocable socioeconomic damage by forcing more than 300,000 families out of their homes in the 1950s and 60s in the name of urban renewal. Here on Google Maps, you can see the two blocks are gone, and in their place are the Park West Village apartments and a Whole Foods market. Today, we talk about displacement of low-income people through gentrification, but gentrification is not strictly restricted to socioeconomic plight. In April of this year, Saheed Vasil was killed by the New York Police Department in Crown Heights as a consequence of gentrification. And tech has been directly responsible for the gentrification of pretty much all of San Francisco. And indirectly, it has made it easier for the local culture in neighborhoods like Highland Park, Inglewood, and Boyle Heights in Los Angeles, Little Havana in Miami, and much of Brooklyn in New York, to be digitally erased by prioritizing commonly searched terms that gain prominence. When we use Google to search for things, we teach those machines that that is the priority, and since many times low-income people don't have access, they don't have a need to Google for something, that means that when there's more attention paid to a neighborhood, when gentrification starts happening, the software that we're writing is backing that up. So algorithms, with the help of machine learning, are not objective. They're instilled with the biases by the people who write them when measures are not taken to consider the consequences of disruption. This is why we need to apply more scrutiny when it comes to whether or not the features we push as software are ethical. Sartre's theory of existentialism dictates that humans create their own values and determine their own meaning for their life. To Sartre, once an oppressive situation is regarded as such by those who feel oppressed, the situation becomes intolerable. We are then compelled to project our intentions onto our present condition and transform them into action. And because ethical dilemmas disproportionately affect underrepresented minorities, it's important to take the time to listen to us instead of just assuming what we need. Some of the most pressing dilemmas right now are surrounding the issues of privacy, surveillance, data, and discrimination. Of course, we've all heard about the way that Cambridge Analytica unethically used Facebook's data, but there are even more serious things happening right now, especially in the United States. The Stop LAPD Spying Coalition recently released a report about the harassment and mistreatment of low-income black people due to the use of predictive policing software by Palantir that they sold to the LAPD and nearly secretly sold to the New Orleans Police Department. Amazon is also trying to get into the business of predictive policing with their product recognition. It has the power to identify people in real-time photos of large groups of people and in crowded events and public places, and most notably, they include race as an identifier, which results in increased bias. None of these issues are new. In 2016, ProPublica uncovered bias in the North Point Compass software. Compass stands for Correctional Offender Management Profiling, for alternative sanctions. And it's used by courts to automatically determine if sentencing based on criminal recidivism scores that are set by questions that have extreme bias against low-income black people. So how do we prevent this kind of discrimination? How do we prevent our software from ending people's lives? We need to agree on what the ethical foundation of our work is in this industry, in the workplace and in the world. In 1985, James Moore detailed in his essay, What is Computer Ethics? These four tenets. It's our responsibility to apply these tenets to the workplace and ask these questions when we talk about machine learning, AI, and data collection, just to name a few. According to Professor Margaret Ann Pierce, she defined the need for the following three ethical influences: an individual personal code, an informal code of ethics, and an informal code of ethics and a code of ethics in the workplace. Because unlike our code, we can't say that we were only taking orders, or as Hannah Arendt called it, rationalizing in the way of the little Eichmanns. I'd like to remember that when we talk about ethics, the root Greek word is ethos, which translates to habit or custom. And that is the key to developing an ethical framework, because we need to be accountable. We need to make it a habit. We need to make it a custom. In the essay Moral Machines by Wendell Wallach and Colin Allen, they wrote about how machine ethics will drive advancement in human ethics by forcing us to address gaps in modern normative theories of ethics. This is our moral imperative. It's our job to consider the ways that our actions are shaping the ethical world. Here are some organizations with their own formal codes. Right now in the United States, the only CS programs that require ethics are the ones that are ABET accredited, but the Association for Computer Machinery, ACM, is considered one of the most appropriate for web development. I urge you all to look up all six of these and pick one. Apply it to your work. Apply it to the decisions that you make. Practicing ethical decision-making in the workplace is about stretching your imagination. The EFF recently published a science fiction story by Cory Doctorow to challenge us to consider the implications of Section 1201 of the DMCA and how coming down hard on copyright infringement will change society. But it's important not just to think about these issues. It's important that we act on them. If you remember Robert Moses, the man who basically pushed all of those people out of Manhattanville, his legacy was extremely far-reaching. He was most notably a big fan of the automobile, and he wanted to build a highway that would run right down the middle of Washington Square Park and carve up the middle of the park, carve up the middle of the neighborhood, and just send trucks and cars right down the middle of the neighborhood. Because he felt that innovation in automobiles were more important than the lives and the people in the communities. He was also making a lot of money for a lot of other people and felt that that was more important than the people who were living in these homes. But he was stopped. There's Washington Square Park, if you've ever been there, has no highway running through it, and that's because of this person. This is Jane Jacobs. She was a writer. She most notably published a book called The Death and Life of Great American Cities, and she was an activist in New York City. When Robert Moses came to that neighborhood, when he came to Washington Square Park, Jane Jacobs organized the people of the neighborhood and put together activism to keep Robert Moses from enacting his plan. Jane Jacobs was really good at the photo op. She put moms with strollers in the middle of the park to protest. And she had a ribbon retying ceremony in the park to mock Robert Moses's ribbon cutting ceremonies that he would do when he opened new highways and bridges. And because she rallied all of these people and participated in civil disobedience, got arrested for protesting at city hearings, the mayor was forced to stop these plans that Robert Moses had to build a highway through the middle of the park. And what ended up happening was he went on and he tried to continue to do this, and as he continued to try to do this in other neighborhoods, tried to carve the middle of Canal Street down later on in New York City, and Jane Jacobs came back and pushed him down. They kept and got to maintain the living that they already had. They were able to defend themselves. And we recently saw this happen too in our industry, because just yesterday, Gizmodo reported that Google will not be pursuing a renewal of their contract for Project Maven with the DoD because of the actions that employees took. Over a dozen employees resigned. Employees signed paperwork saying that they did not believe that this was an ethical decision, that they did not want to participate in writing AI software for drones. And because of this, just like the civil disobedience and the activism of Jane Jacobs, we too can have an effect on our industry. If people, companies are willing to... Consider how much money companies are willing to pay to get our attention, how much money they're willing to pay us in salaries, how much money they're spending to sponsor conferences just like this one. We have power over them as a collective group, and we need to, it's our moral imperative to use that power for good and not for evil. And we need to come up with an ethical framework to do that that is more explicit than just good versus evil. We need to decide on codes of ethics the same way that we decide on codes of conduct for our conferences. Codes of conduct are just ethical codes of ethics that we apply to our internal group. It's deciding the ways that we want to treat the people in our society. So we need to apply the same kind of codes to our work and the world at large. It's our job to design computers, to design phones, to design software in a way that no one dies. and to consider the historical, global, political, social, and economic repercussions of the work that we do. So I want to encourage each and every one of you to consider the ways that you can make your work more ethical, the ways that you can prevent people from being harmed by the software that you write, whether it be through gentrification in maps, whether it be through AI having bias and machine learning having bias, or even just on your team, when your teammates are the subject of their own oppression. What are you doing with your power to help the people who you work with and the people of the world at large? Thank you, sir. Because God will not have his work made manifest by cowards. You have to be brave. You have to take that responsibility on yourself. Thank you.